Hachette Audio presents Martin Scorsese, A Journey. Written by Mary Pat Kelly. Read by Nancy Linari and PJ Ochlan. The burning sands will become pools, and the thirsty ground, springs of water. A highway will be there, called the Holy Way. No fool shall go astray on it. No lion will be there. It is for those with a journey to make. Isaiah chapter 35, verses 7 through 9.
Foreword by Leonardo DiCaprio. Martin Scorsese and I met for the first time in the early 90s in, of course, the East Village in New York City. I was just 18 years old, and What's Eating Gilbert Grape had just come out. Marty was rushing out of an event as I was walking in. I immediately recognized him, but I had no reason to believe he even knew who I was. Then he stopped, looked at me, and said, "Hey kid, you did a terrific job in that picture. I hope we get to work together one day." I was stunned. My connection to Martin Scorsese goes back further than that afternoon in the hotel lobby. It goes back to my father, who, when I told him I wanted to be an actor, said to me, "If you're going to act in movies, there are two people you need to watch and learn from: Martin Scorsese and Robert De Niro. It doesn't get any better." At 14, I gave myself a crash course in film history, starting with Marty's filmography. I was riveted. The film that hit me the hardest was Taxi Driver. As a young man, I identified with Travis's loneliness, his longing, and his awkwardness. And then, when he tried to assassinate the presidential candidate, he betrayed the audience. He betrayed me. I had never experienced anything like Taxi Driver. That character and that film marked me forever. Years went by, and I went on and did a number of other films, culminating with the success of Titanic. I was in a unique position, given the freedom to make decisions unlike ever before. Everyone was asking me what kind of pictures I wanted to make and whom I wanted to make them with. I had one answer: Martin Scorsese. Then an opportunity came. Gangs of New York. Making that film gave me an understanding of the magnitude of his artistry. It elevated my interest and passion in movies and the craft of acting more than I could have ever imagined. It was a life-changing experience. Over the last 20 years, I've been lucky enough to have made 5 more films with Marty, and each one has not only been its own unique creative experience, but also an education in film history. Cinema is in Marty's DNA, and of course he's never stopped tirelessly fighting for its survival and development as an art form. After all, no one knows cinema as he does. When we're preparing for a project, he will screen older classic movies for all the actors to give us ideas for character behavior, rhythms of speech, and body language. The actual shoot is a whole different kind of learning experience. Marty is always open to the actor's ideas and instincts. His relationships with the actors he works with are so paramount that the plot seems secondary. The truth, the humanity of these people that he's putting up on screen, is always his focus. He will not stop until he's created something alive and lasting. As one would, I find it difficult to encapsulate the breadth of what Marty himself has contributed to cinema history. Having spent many hours watching films together, he was the first to show me Italian neo-realist classics: De Sica's Bicycle Thieves, Shoeshine, and Umberto D, and Rossellini's Paisan. It was during those screenings that I realized how he was inspired to bring a gritty truth to American cinema that never existed before, certainly for his generation. It's all there very early on in Mean Streets, an intensely personal movie made from the eyes of a young voyeur expressing the truth of life he'd discovered through cinema. This was a conscious effort of a young artist, an outsider, creating a new cinematic language. In many ways, he has done for American filmmaking what Marlon Brando did for the art of acting. Like any great artist, Marty cannot be defined by one genre or medium. He continues to challenge himself, never afraid to experiment with new concepts and advancements. He has been bold in the choices he has made and the stories he has told, achieving higher levels of artistry by always challenging his own outlook. He has set a new standard for filmmaking, a standard he's maintained for 50 years and counting. More than even the films we've made together, Marty has given me something invaluable, something that I will carry for a lifetime, a profound appreciation for the art of cinema, and a full understanding of just how blessed I am to be a part of its history. I am fortunate to have collaborated so many times with a cinematic legend, but even more so, to have found a cinematic father, teacher, and friend in this ever-changing industry. He's a modest man, so it's hard to do justice to the magnitude of all that he's contributed. But in all honesty, I can't imagine what the world or cinema would be like without him. We love you, Marty. Leonardo DiCaprio. Foreword by Steven Spielberg. My movies are whispers. Marty's movies are shouts. There are a few things we have in common, though, even if they're not always apparent. There's our friendship, first of all. I've known him for the better part of 2 decades now, and for most of that time, he doesn't know this, I've been a bit in awe of him. And then there's all the emotion. That's another thing. Both of us make movies that provoke strong reactions. Movies that make an audience respond. The difference is that Marty does this all on his own terms. He doesn't fret about what's going to work or not work for an audience. His concern is what's true to his characters and what's right for their feelings. If he can work that out, and he always does, then he goes right ahead and lets the audience catch up with him. And if they don't, Marty doesn't wait around for them. I admire that too. Maybe I even envy it a little. Francis Coppola also takes those big chances. He goes his own way. That's the best way, and that's why I think Francis and Marty are the two best filmmakers working in America right now. They are artists, of course, but they are also great explorers, always taking risks, always crossing emotional frontiers, always striking out for fresh territory. Being with Marty is like watching one of his movies. It's a kinetic experience. There's a greeting, warm and fast, and then you go spinning off on a dizzying ride full of ideas, memories, wisecracks, and personal investigations. For anyone who hasn't had the luck to spend some time with Marty, watching him act is a good guide to what it can be like. Think of the characters he's played, and played well, too. The gunman in Mean Streets, the passenger full of murderous rage in Taxi Driver, the volatile club owner in Tavernier's Round Midnight. You can't trust these guys. You can't trust what they're thinking, and you can't predict what they're going to do. It's the same with Marty himself, with one big difference. There's something threatening about all these characters, but the only thing you risk being with Marty is a sudden, drastic loss of energy. It's hard keeping pace with the guy. In his movies, Marty sets the pace, along with a punishingly high standard. He makes movies about things that a lot of us are afraid to admit we even think about. Movies like Mean Streets and Raging Bull and The Last Temptation of Christ make us confront troubling thoughts and stormy feelings, then make us understand them. Lots of directors can make movies that make you feel things easily, temporarily. Marty's movies can change you, and they cling to your heart forever. Foreword by Michael Powell.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.